1831, at the age of 22, Charles Darwin set off on a voyage that would change not only his life, but ours as well. A naturalist on a British naval ship, Beagle, Darwin traveled around South America and beyond. What he saw on an isolated group of islands out here in the Pacific began an intellectual voyage that would last some 20 years. It would culminate in the then shocking idea that living things are not designed according to an unchangeable plan, but instead are shaped by the world around them. These huge reptiles seemed to my fancy like some antediluvian animals. I was always amused when overtaking one of these great monsters as it was quietly pacing along to see how suddenly, the instant I passed, it would draw in its head and legs
and uttering a deep voice, fall to the ground with a heavy sound as if struck dead. I frequently got on their backs, and then giving a few raps on the hinder part of their shells, they would rise up and walk away. But I found it very difficult to keep my balance.
Today, visitors to the Galapagos usually pay their respects to the handful of drums recorded at the house at the Houston station here, more than the 12 times. Although getting to see them in the city is reserved for the full life. These mockingbirds, like the saddle-tailed poet, are something I learned in Spanish.
These mockingbirds are having a flick fight. They flick their wings and their tail back and forth. It's a territorial display between two big groups of mockingbirds that are families. And they're disputing what's going on at the territorial boundary of each other. And they do this big display saying, you know, if you cross this boundary, this is what's going to happen to you. It's going to be bad.
Mockingbirds are a passive presence in the camp of Spanova, and they seem eager to volunteer for the show and tell.
On this island, the mockingbird species is larger than on other islands. This island, the beak is long and curved. You use that to move dirt around and dig more on this island than on other islands. And also, the breast feathers are whitish and speckled, and some of the other species are much cleaner than the breast. The point is that nearby islands have a very different looking bird. It's no problem for even amateur birds to know the difference between species of mockingbirds.
Mockingbirds joined the giant tortoises on Darwin's list of creatures that, for some mysterious reason, were slightly different on different islands.
I'll make this mockingbird wake up.
He's going to be a most dramatic suggestion.
Thank you.
though as a little world within itself, or rather a satellite attached to America, whence it is derived a few stray colonies. Hence, both in space and time, you seem to be brought somewhere near to that great fact, that mystery of mysteries, the first appearance of new beings on this earth.
This just needs to be loose like this?
Yeah, what happens is the bird flies in and it doesn't see it, and then so it carries the net out with it with its momentum and then sags down, hanging like this in a little bag.
Can they hear that?
It doesn't go like this.
Did you do that when you've been here too long?
Birders act like they know what they're doing, and they make these little squeak sounds, and they all pretend like it makes a difference. I don't know if it does or not.
But you got one,
yeah.
It's a sharp-beaked ground fish.
Our bizarre calls have netted us a bird from one of the 13 different species of finches in the Galapagos, birds that are today known collectively as Darwin finches.
Now, what is this?
This is the sharp-beaked ground finch. This is the smallest ground finch on this island. It's got a pointy little beak that's great for grass beaks.
His net intake would probably be negative.
So he could, although he's probably eating all day long, he would eventually starve to death.
Yeah. He's got expenses. He's got overhead. He's got a head.
But
you can, you know, you look at the body size, and he's got a lot more overhead than this one.
The first thing that I want to do is to make sure that the people who are in the world are in the world.
Well, there's some folks who call Daphne Major the laboratory of evolution. It's a really great place to see evolution actually happening because the system, the biological system, is relatively simple. Not too many components, and for the fishes, it kind of boils down to what seeds are here and what tool do I have to craft those seeds. Does change over short periods of time. And they know exactly why. It's because the food supply changes.
And that's a case of actually seeing evolution in progress. You see it as it happens.
Yeah. The really cool thing about this, for everybody, scientists and everybody else, is that there's no question that it is evolution happening in front of our eyes. We don't have to think of evolution as being something that you only get from the fossil record or theorizing about. You can go to a place like Daphne Major, where it's simple, and you can actually see the evolution happening on almost a monthly basis, but certainly an annual basis.
I've often heard people say, people sympathetic to the idea of evolution, that you have to take a little bit of it on faith, so you don't have to take anything on faith.
Not anymore, not after this study.
Rivers in South American continent. And they flew way out there, 600 miles.
And actually, first spoke of land, I thought it was just like, twigs or branches.
Large chunks of land that even have standing trees that have been seen floating way out to sea in the ocean. And those can easily bring several species that once you learn in a system like this.
Charles Darwin, had he ever heard of Godzilla, might have agreed.
It is a hideous-looking creature, stupid and sluggish in its movements. When in the water, this lizard swims with perfect ease and quickness by a serpentine movement of its body and flattened tail, the legs being motionless and collapsed at its sides. I opened the stomachs of several and found them largely distended with mixed seaweed.
Darwin put his finger on just those adaptations that have made them a unicorn and fit so perfectly into its island home.
The only ones that breathe.
Yeah, all that sea lettuce,
Olga,
is their favorite food.
The ancestors of these creatures were like all the other lizards in the world, swimming only when they had to. But there's a lot of birds.
During the last great El Nino?
Well, it was horrible. Those guys are about 10% of all the animals that were here.
There were 10 times as many.
10 times as many. And they were going to forage. They were trying to get the lost bits of algae and then slowly walking up the beach. And sometimes they didn't make it up the beach. So they would just sort of put one foot forward and still try to go up the sand, really bake in the sand literally. They just all died. So we had, I think, like 400 dead animals living in a few weeks. That's pretty amazing.
Now, is that because all the green that we see here was not here?
Yep. All the green you see was totally black. There was absolutely nothing growing on these rocks.
That even during good years, the marine iguanas here in China of the have to struggle to make a living.
Why do we see so many smaller iguanas with life?
Without getting to the kids. And that means this is algae. You probably saw iguanas foraging already.
Yes.
Okay. They sometimes have these huge algae pastures that they just edit the mouthful of algae every bite. But here they only have a tiny little carpet of algae and they constantly have to scrape it off.
So that has selected out the big ones. Absolutely. The big ones that might be born here.
Right.
Just aren't going to get a nutrient.
Absolutely.
So there they are. That's the product of natural selection.
Right.
But even among these smaller than average animals, some of the males are clearly larger.
This big guy has walked through the entire collection doing that nodding thing, which is to announce his territory, right?
But is he the only one in this whole box this way? Like dominant, like that. These dogs are these definitely the prize man because you see all these females around here.
Yeah,
they all like to hang out with him. So the females are the ones who choose in their system, and the males just try to be the best to be chosen.
the females are attracted to this big handsome guy. I know you come here every day and you kind of like the way they look at me, but I'm telling you, I'm just not here.
You can be here 30 days if you like
me. Yeah, right. Okay.
Yes, Martin actually does spend the entire 30 days the iguanas here are deciding to mate, watching to see which males the females pick. It's an important decision.
Each of those females only have one egg.
Oh, really?
That's what they mate. They have about 25% of their body mass in one egg.
So it really counts who they choose.
Absolutely.
Martin is trying to understand why, if the big guys are so popular, the group here also contains a number of much smaller men who, instead of showing off, keep a deliberately low profile.
You see that guy? He was sort of sneaking up on the female, trying to get her. That's one of these small, sneaky men that came out in the territories. And they try to sort of sneak up on the females. They're about the female size, so the male can't tell them from the females. So they just try to sneak up on females and try to make for them with this camera.
So in a way, he gets an advantage. He has a chance to sneak up because he's a female impersonator.
Right up until the last moment.
There must be some reason the females accept the sneakers, or natural selection would have long since eliminated them. Martin's hypothesis is that keeping smallness to them provides the females with a sort of insurance policy against those brutal El Niño years, when being big can be fatal.
And that seems to be sort of a long-term strategy that they can't really know when the next El Niño hits. So sometimes they might just see a small guy as a mating partner. They have some smaller offspring, and then some other times they might choose a bigger one.
One year you try it big, next year you try it small, and you protect yourself all the way around.
The point will make it easier to keep an eye on.
Is it possible that this will turn out to be some cue to the females that this guy should be avoided at all costs? Do they take any visual cues?
Many people at conferences also.
Oh, yeah?
You see, tested because in the lowest, in other lizards, it would make a big difference. But in those guys, it doesn't. So the females don't go for coloration, they don't care about the markings they put on them. They probably only go for the size and for the behavior.
Yeah, but this guy is now clearly a movie star. Why did I not notice that?
It is true. So that's it for this guy. I can go.
Martin Wachowski isn't the first scientist to catch and release marine iguanas here in the Galapagos.
I threw one several times as far as I could into a deep pool left by the retiring tide. But it invariably returned in a direct line to the spot where I stood. Perhaps this singular piece of apparent stupidity may be accounted for by the circumstance that this reptile has no enemy whatever on the shore, whereas at sea, it must often fall a prey to the numerous sharks. Hence, probably urged by a fixed and hereditary instinct that the shore is its place of safety, whatever the emergency may be, it there takes refuge.
Slowly sculptured by the living of the planet. David has been studying mass bullying for half his life, trying to understand a singularly gruesome sight.
Yes,
that this young booby, all fluffy and apparently innocent, may well have committed murder.
Maybe a 35, 40-day-old mass booby chick. And it can give you a good nip. So if you would like to hold this bird, it can give you a good nip, so if I would like to look at it, like that. Yeah, that's what now, don't squeeze it yet. Just get up around the head.
Not only is this baby booby a natural-born killer, the creature it may have killed was its own sibling.
We're going to give this bird a name. Probably already has a name, but I'm going to call it 95289.
Dave Anderson wants to know why the murder occurred. Even more, he wants to know why the parents did nothing to stop it.
And we will put this little chick back in his home. Chick needs to calm down.
To answer this question, Anderson has been coming to the island of West Africa for 20 years. For the first few days, the chicks amicably share their nest, but on day five, things turn nasty. The main thing the parent is providing for the chick is shelter from the glare of the sun. The older chick is trying to push the younger out from the shade to a slow but certain death. Throughout this struggle, the parent remains aloof and apparently indifferent.
The parent is not going to do anything about this sibilicide. You call it sibilicide, the killing of a sibling. If it's like most mass booby parents, it will simply watch or look around or do something else, but it will not help this poor offspring that's being killed by its own sibling. The first time I saw this happen, I couldn't believe what bad luck the beach chick had. Its closest relative in the world is throwing it out of the nest to die on the hot ground with sunstroke. It's sort of a miserable thing to see. I've seen it enough times now that I accept that that's the normal way of booby life, but it is kind of shocking the first time you see it.
Shocking, and in Darwinian terms, baffling. At least at first sight. After all, that's the parents' own genes lying there dying.
I don't understand the economics of this. She's going to lay two eggs. And everybody knows that the first one is going to kill the second one. Why expend all that energy? The way
it seems like a waste.
Yeah.
In terms of natural selection, selection is going to maximize the excess benefit over the cost. So certainly the benefit has to exceed the cost. In this case, there's a benefit to laying the second egg, even if you only want one chick, because they have lousy hatching success. It only hatches about 60% of their eggs, even if you eliminate accident success. Something about fertility or embryo development causes 40% of them to die. So if you're going to get one chick, you got to have one chick. you're prepared to pay the price of a second visit, even though it's expensive, because if the first one fails, the second one can take its place.
It seems to me that once you've gone to the trouble of waiting 2 weeks, you have a good shot at having two healthy adults come out of that. Isn't your purpose better served to let both of them live?
Yeah, good question. If you experimentally stop the syphilisites from happening and make them play nice,
yeah,
and then challenge the parents to bring back enough food for two, about 30% of the time they can do it. She doesn't stop feeding. If there are toothpicks in front of her, she'll feed them. You know, open mouth, putting food. That's what she does. And if there are two of them there, she puts it in at twice the rate. So you say, well, they definitely should be stopping the syphilisite from happening. However, if you follow those parents another year, you find out in the year after they raise two chicks, they take it on the chin in terms of survival, particularly the moms. Regular moms survive at about 92% over from year to year, and the experimentals that have had to raise two chicks survive about 75%, and that's a huge cost.
A cost that, in terms of natural selection, simply cannot be sustained.
This is really fascinating, but on the other hand, I'm spending just a few hours talking to you about this, and you're spending your life on it. How did you get led to that?
It's a problem that on the surface seems fairly easy to address. The problem being, why lay that second egg? Given you lay a second egg, why not try to raise two chicks? But to actually look at how selection acts on individuals, you really ought to have a long-term perspective. And following the lifetime consequences of a long-lived animal may take up most of your career. Some of the birds that I have initiated the study of as babies are going to outlive my career.
But many won't. Even chicks that have won the battle of the most well-bred and mocking birds, taking them to the blood.
Continental systems, as opposed to here, because here the animals do their suffering out in the open, and particularly these groovy stages have miserable life you wouldn't wish on your worst enemy. All these terrible things that can happen to you, it's really apparent because they're not making it.
Go right into the rats. They go in the landing one of those worlds and EPA and kill them halfway.
Don't be shy. He's ours.
This one's about a year and a half old.
Yeah. And how old will we get the babies working?
Well, we can guarantee that they live between 60 and 90 years old. But history books and stories that are a bit difficult to confirm say anything up to 150, 200 years.
The project owes its success largely to this man, Cruz Marquez, who, with his colleagues, had had to invent the captive breeding process as they went along. A critical realization was that the sex of the hatchling depends upon the temperature at which the eggs are incubated. 29.5 degrees Celsius gives you female. 48 degrees Celsius, and you get male.
Sounds like you must have been a pretty sophisticated system here to keep the temperature what you need it to be.
We have an incredibly sophisticated system. We have a hair dryer connected to a thermostat here on continuous cycles.
Despite the shoestring budget, the captive breeding program has resulted in some 800 Española tortoises being returned to their native island. Making this possible was an ambitious and successful program aimed at ridding the island of goats, the tortoise's main competitor for resources.
In Galapagos aren't doing particularly well. When El Nino events come into the archipelago, which happens every so often, the waters get very, very warm and the normal fish life around here begins to die off. When that happens, penguin populations crash. In 1982-83, they crashed by over 50%. This last year, 1997-98, they crashed again. And the thing that confuses us is they don't recuperate after those crashes. Now that worries us because, of course, if the populations crash every so often and never recuperate, they can go extinct.
How is the sex rats are the culprit, invading the rock crevices where penguins lay their eggs and raise their chicks? So he's conducting an experiment to see what can be done to save the penguins, short of the impossible task of ridding the Galapagos of rats entirely.
Now what we're trying to do is use these islands, these small islands, as models for the rest of the Galapagos. And we're removing the rats by poisoning them from some of these islands and leaving them on others. The idea is to try and measure how few rats we can remove to increase penguin reproduction. That way, we can invest enough money to increase penguin reproduction, but not so much money that we can't do other things also. It's really about trying to divvy up limited resources for the conservationist biology that we're all about.
Thank you.
companies like ourselves who benefit from deep profits from being able to bring things to the table are in the position to make a difference. And in the last year, the year since we've been here, we've raised about $200,000 on guests. And when you think that we represent 5% of tourism to the island, and if we multiply this kind of an activity times 20, all of a sudden tourists could have participated in places like the Southwest Houston Station and the National Park, and they wouldn't have to struggle so much for funding.
But there's an irony here. Tourists bring in not only dollars, they've also attracted thousands of Ecuadorians to the island to work in the tourism industry. Together, tourists and residents pose a new threat to the island's ecosystem.
Because there are 16 or 40,000 people that live in the Galapagos Islands, five supply ships run out here two or three times a month each, and there are three 727s a day that fly into the Galapagos Islands. All of that activity brings in a tremendous amount of material, tons and tons and tons of food and construction materials into the Galapagos every year. Somewhere in those packages are the infinite species of tomorrow. It's not purposeful nowadays, but it's every bit as damaging as if it was.
I've come to see for myself one of the worst of these alien invaders. Charlotte Costa at the Darwin Research Station is showing the way.
What about these little white things?
Okay, this is the white, the Copernican scale that's been introduced, scale and set. It was introduced in 1982 and into the island of San Cristobal. And since then, it's spread to among other islands in the archipelago. It attacks over 40 plant species. In the absence of its natural measures, it's just gone haywire.
How was it introduced?
We're not sure. We think it's introduced in some of the coastal trees that were imported to the island. But then again, it could have been some citrus. It was definitely on a plant and accidentally introduced.
The cottony cushion scale is one of hundreds of non-native insects that have recently sneaked into the island. And Charlotte is one of only two entomologists.
You have to go after them species by species, find out what they do, what harm they cause, and how you can protect against them. And by the time you find that out about one species, you probably got another 300 on your list. How does that make you feel?
It's daunting, the prospect.
The magnitude of the problems that face the Galapagos Islands can appear overwhelming. In fact, they are overwhelming. But the one thing that people that are motivated to conserve biological diversity in the Galapagos Islands keep at the forefront all the time is that this is really one of the last oceanic archipelagos in the world where we have an opportunity to maintain a pristine environment. There are 95 to 96% of the species that ever live in the Galapagos Islands that are alive today. Some of them are in bad state. Some of them may go extinct before too long if we're not successful at restoration efforts for them. But the point is we have an opportunity here. The world, actually, it's not just Ecuador, it's not just the research stations, it's not just the National Park Service, but the world has an opportunity to preserve biological diversity in a pristine state.
Now, what about this? Why should anybody else who's not a scientist care about preserving the Galapagos? If the Galapagos disappears, then we didn't need place. It's run over by introduced species. So what? There's a bank of genetic information. And it can be squandered or it can be preserved in its current state. The analogy is often made with a library, is that you wouldn't go into a library and wantonly destroy a whole bunch of stuff to make shelf room, to put knickknacks on. Well, here we've got creatures that have been coming up with solutions to particular problems for a long, long time, and there'll be problems in the future that we will need some of those solutions. They're here. Preserve them.
I think it's also a place of joy and inside international ecosystems. And you can't really predict what people will find here in the future. But like the Galapagos is inspired by all these, but that is laboratory of evolution. And I think many people will in the future. And you can because you find it interesting. So I think it really will continue to be a lab of evolution where you can really see these processes happening.
Thank you. a transcript of this program, send $5 to Scientific American Frontiers, 70 Coolidge Hill Road, Watertown, Massachusetts, 02472. Be sure to specify which episode you'd like.